Speaking of perspectives at the local level, again, we want to ensure and highlight the fact for others that don't live in the Arctic that actually people live in the Arctic. They make decisions at the community level that impacts them. They should be driving the decision-making modeling, whether that's in their policy development or working with scientists to figure out what is happening. That should be informed at the community level. And we have a tendency, we have a tendency to think about Alaska or the Arctic, and realizing we have very different Arctics, whether it's the North American Arctic, the Eurasian Arctic, on and on. And people are different. And we want to continue to ground the work that we do in understanding better what is happening in our communities. So we've asked our friend Liz Cravalho from Kotzebue to lead a panel to provide for you and us perspective of what's happening in these communities, not from economic development, not from science, yes, but not exclusively, from the perspective of those who actually live in the communities directly impacted by the change, and also what they can do with this change to serve their community better. Liz, thank you so much for bringing together an outstanding panel, and I will let you all lead this and introduce yourselves. And thank you all very much for coming.
All right, thank you. I guess we don't have to push. I think it's already on.
I made an executive decision, and my executive decision is to add a few moments onto your time, knowing that we're trying to move this around a little bit.
Thank you so much, Mike. I really appreciate that. Uvlalotak, Ataga Kolok, Kikik Tagrok Minurunga, Akaga Ijiktak, Apaga Igak, Anaga Aporak. Good morning, distinguished panelists and guests. My Inupiaq name is Kolok. I'm Liz Cravalho. I'm from Kotzebue, Alaska. My mother and father are Nellie and Greg Moore, and my late grandmother is Ada Ward. She grew up at Cape Blossom, just outside of Kotzebue. I serve as the Vice President of Lands at NANA, and I also serve on the Arctic Economic Council as the Inuit Circumpolar Council member to that board. And today I have the pleasure of working with our panelists here to my left to bring Arctic Alaska Native perspectives on the changing Arctic to you. The Indigenous people of the Alaskan Arctic have been engaged in the international sphere since the 1970s or even longer through organizations like the Inuit Circumpolar Council and others to secure our rights to continue our traditional way of life and the long-term sustainability of our people. Yesterday, we heard about the importance of engaging and including Indigenous Arctic people from the beginning of all Arctic efforts, which we just heard about a little bit more, whether that is research, national security, addressing climate change, or developing a sustainable Arctic economy. The Arctic may be a frontier today for policymakers and researchers. However, the Arctic is and has been our homeland for thousands of years. Many of us have learned a lot of different lessons from our elders and bring that today to you. Each of today's panelists bring a unique viewpoint of what challenges and opportunities are facing our respective communities right now, and the policy decisions made here in DC, as well as what is studied through research, who is included, and how data and studies are used, all have direct implications for the lives of Arctic Alaska Natives and both the subsistence and cash economies that we rely on for our livelihood. So I'm gonna do the best I can to stop my talking here and open it up to our panelists who have a lot to share with you today. So I'd like to have each of the panelists introduce themselves, and then we'll have a short video and we'll go into panelist questions.
Who's first? You can, okay. Uvlalotak, Uvanga Maktoyak, Sitnsamurunga, Johnson Koyarunga, Angayukaka, Alan Johnson, Junior Lou, Sarah Jack Lou, Atataka, Alan Johnson, Senior Lou, Teresa Norbert Lou, Suli, Raymond Sidamona Lou, Edna Alexander Lou, Suli, Louis Jack Lou, Daisy Noekak Lou, Savaktunga, Bering Sea Elders Group, me, Executive Director, me, Aussie, University of Alaska, Anchorage, me, Ilisari, Inupiaq. So good morning, my Inupiaq name is Maktoyak. I'm from the community of Nome, Alaska. I'm from the Johnson family. My parents are Alan Johnson Jr. and Sarah Jack. I have three sets of grandparents. My paternal grandparents were the late Alan Johnson Sr. and Teresa Norbert, and on my mother's side, Raymond Sitamona and Edna Alexander, but I was raised by Louis Jack and Daisy Noekuk. I work at Bering Sea Elders Group as the executive director. I'm also an Inupiaq teacher at the University of Alaska in Anchorage, and happy to be here. Koyan.
Good morning. I'm thankful to be here. My name is Hugh Patkotak Sr., born and raised from the village of Wainwright. From just sitting here, it's an honor to be able to introduce myself as an Inupiaq, having lived a dream, primarily the ability to make a living on what I say the best of both worlds in a Western society and the way of making a living back at home from that perspective. And certainly have enjoyed it. I'm proud to be here. You know, this is a dream come true for me, primarily meaning, you know, I ask myself once in a while and ask certain people, what country do we live in? I'm thankful to be able to present to you our video in the near future. Introduce myself where I was born and raised, called a village of Wainwright, called Ulonik, known for good people, you know, throughout time. At the end of the day, our primary responsibility has been to, you know, bring the concerns of our areas, seeing the difference. Thank you for the introduction. Thanks.
Should be on.
Hello? Okay. Kuyakam si Honga atka yupi gustundun kat Iyanga, lalurum gustundun kat Delbert Pungowiyi. My Yupik given name is Iyanga. It is the beginning of our songs. Some of you may have heard that Iyanga, Iyanga. I was born in 1959. My father, Dennis Pungowiyi, Yupik name Suputak. My mother, Jean Pungowiyi. On my mother's side, my grandparents, Alfred Tumlu and Romola Tumlu, who I was a grandfather's child. My mother's father's side, Laura Pungowiyi and Donald Pungowiyi. I'm from Savonga, Alaska, St. Lawrence Island. Thank you.
Thank you. I think we'd like to go to the video now.
For generations, the Inupiaq people have subsisted on all that we could find in the land and the sea that surrounds us. When you grew up on the northernmost coast of Alaska, as I did, the Chukchi Sea is your front yard. And the tundra that covers Alaska's north slope is your backyard. My name is Hugh Patkotak Sr., born and raised at the village of Wainwright, 1957. I come from a family of seven of siblings, mother and father, raised in a dog teaming era when we didn't have, back then we didn't have even runways out by the village. Planes used to come land on the ice and on the beach. For generations, the ice has been part of our defense, protecting our coastline and our community. Families have worked together to hunt and bring back food that could be cached in ice cellars, what we call sigaloks, coal storage carved into the permafrost beneath our feet. A whaling crew could fit hundreds of pounds of muktuk and trust that it would be preserved to feed families throughout the year and remain frozen even during summer. For the Inupiaq people, ice is more than food preservation. Sea ice is also a food access, a bridge that connects us to the deepest parts of the sea. On North Slope, we invest in sturdy snow fences. These fences could hold back blowing, drifted snow that threatens to bury villages. The snow makes a difference. During our long winters, we have trusted the sea ice to be our coastal ice fence, protecting our village from the outside world. Throughout my life, I have noticed the changes in how the ice has been forming. In reality, you rarely ever see old ice, multi-year ice. He was asked to join his first whaling crew in the 1940s, fetching snow and ice for the crew's cook. He would look for pikaluyak, the blue freshwater ice on top of the sea ice. That's something you don't really see anymore. You only find it on older, multi-year ice, and that stuff is wonderful to drink, clean and fresh. Kind of unique sight. He shared stories about hunters climbing the pressure ridges in the sea ice, Cecil Mountains for us. Once upon a time, they could better spot whale and walrus and seals perched on top of these ridges, these what you call pressure ridges. Over the years, he began to notice the changes of sea ice. The pressure ridges, which were grounded underwater, frozen fast in seafloor, had always served a dual purpose: high ground for spotting whales and a safe zone during a storm. Hunters knew they were anchored to the seafloor if they could shelter by a ridge, but as years went by, the ridges diminished. The 1970s, he said, were the last time he remembers pressure ridges like mountains. I haven't seen ice like that since, he said. After growing up in the village, I went away to boarding school, eventually decided to pursue my dream of becoming a professional pilot. And I can verify that as a professional pilot, I have flown about 294 miles northwest of Barrow, helping or assisting the Coast Guard with scientific equipment. And I was dismayed or surprised by all the flat young ice all the way to that direction. Safety is always on our mind in Wainwright. We want our hunters and workers and travelers to return home safely. We operate in some of the harshest environments in the world. Every minute counts. Our search and rescue efforts have to be rapid and precise. As the climate has changed, the sea ice that my ancestors relied on for centuries has diminished. Our communities are left exposed. The water is open for longer periods of time, even when the ice is in. The ratio of multi-year ice to young ice is out of balance. There is concern about ice shelters flooding from melting permafrost as temperatures rise. Families have lost an entire season worth of food. For us, adaptation is in our blood. That's how we have survived for centuries. But sometimes change happens so fast that we're racing to keep up. I do not doubt that the Inupiat people can and will adapt. We have always embraced the realities of our home. If we have lost our ice fence, our leaders have to consider the practical needs of our region. To maintain our commitment to safety, we need to look forward. We are looking ahead.
Awesome. Thank you so much. I just want to extend my appreciation to Hugh and Olgunik for sharing this video. I think that's such a powerful way to share a little bit about our communities and bring some visibility to you all who may not have been to this area of the country, even though there's a lot of diversity across all of our regions. So what I'd like to do is jump into some questions and just put them out to the panel, and then maybe if you all have questions to the audience, you can come up to the microphone as we have time. So I want to ask the panel, what challenges and opportunities do you see now and in the future that are facing your communities as it relates to the changing Arctic? For example, some of the things that were raised in the video, like search and rescue, changes in sea ice, and how maybe that's impacting subsistence, but also seeing the increased need for national security presence in the Arctic.
So for the 39 tribal elders that I serve along the Bering Sea coast, the elders that I work for, they continually refer to the Northern Bering Sea as their grocery store. As an example I provided yesterday in some of my meetings, we do not have the luxury of pulling up on our phone, looking for convenience. We populated our phone, you know, with the map with CVS, and there was like 50 CVSs, that came up. Almost 100% of the households on the Bering Sea coast rely on the marine mammals and fish year round. It's critical for our survival as Indigenous people. But it's being treated as a newly discovered highway. More and more ships are coming along, and there's no inclusion of Alaska Native tribal leadership in the decisions that are made where we live. There's a complete disconnect in the activities that others may view as opportunities are in fact challenges for us. As climate change warms this area for longer periods of time, including this year most significantly, more and more of the area is just impacted, and it impacts our survival as Indigenous people. So just to continue, you know, it's inclusion of perspectives from the Indigenous perspective in regards to climate change, shipping, and other marine traffic.
Hugh, would you like to share your thoughts?
Yes, ma'am, thank you. Thinking about climate change, you know, the topic has been in our forefront. I'll give you a little bit of history of where I come from. Having flown professionally and being part of forums such as this or conferences where we're primarily geared for search and rescue before, I mean, there was some interest a while back, and I was involved with search and rescue. And there was a whole bunch of high-level folks from Russia, United States, Canada, Greenland, talking about this before business. And thinking from that perspective, I was put on the spot. Why would somebody put me on? Because I was living there and knowing where we're from, thinking about infrastructure, thinking about climate change. And things got to be, and it was really interesting. But it got us to think about what we do for a living. You know, like for ice sellers, flooding and melting, impacting our whaling crews and communities who rely on them for food preservation. Very important. You see our brief video how we store food. Now that's being challenged. Home foundations. Permafrost melting means that land is really swallowing our homes. That's a hard pill to swallow when you look at your neighbors and their houses starting to tilt. Coastal erosion. Without our ice fence, Alaska's coast is degrading. It's really challenging. How do we move? Yet at the same time, we're surrounded by boundaries, state land, federal land, coastal land, coastal waters, international waters. How do you face that? How do you face those? We're leading to the loss of land and infrastructure. Really challenging. But just at the same time, I think about the current problem that we have, trying to make a living. From a hunting point of view, things are happening so quickly. So quickly. Like this time of year, man, beautiful time of year for us being back at home today in July. Is the ability to hunt off the sea. And we used to be able to get on the sea ice, just kind of basically float out there and hunt at the same time. We really don't have too much of that anymore. And when you think about it, you know, the reason why I dress the way I dress sometimes is just like a good presentation. What I'm wearing today is what I hunted. Now I wear it. I'm thankful for that. And be able to participate in the Western culture. And I asked the same question to folks here. What country do we live in? And, you know, it's a land of opportunity and full of challenges. Awareness of our Arctic nations. Situational awareness, when you think about that
area where I'm from, where we're from, when you think about the people that we have, raw resources, humans, and land, but yet simply, how can we help our nation, been part of it with a dew line? Thank you.
Thank you, Hugh.
Just to give you a perspective of myself, I was born in 1959. We had no electricity, no motorized vehicles. We were still in dog teams. Oil heaters were just starting to be introduced. I grew up with 9 solid months of winter. On my island, you could see there with that star on St. Lawrence Island in Savunga. To our people, since time immemorial, our artifacts date to be over 2000 BC. To us, winter in my language is uksok. When winter sets in, to us, the polar ice, when it comes and sets the winter, what the scientists call the multi-year ice, which has been around since the last ice age. When the whole of the Bering Sea is locked up with ice, there is no open water to the north and to the south of our island, 100 miles south of our island. The men would go out in the ice 15 miles plus hunting, and now we have 3 months of ice. 3 months. To us, it is not winter anymore because there's a lot of open water. We have no more shore fast ice within the last 5 years. We see the ocean rising. Our beaches are getting shorter. So I was raised by my grandfather and taught the old ways from our ancestral times. I went to the Western school, and then after that he said, you go to our school now. And Amos Pinaya, who was estimated to be 109 at his passing, he taught us about our people from since time immemorial, when our Creator put us here on this earth, that we were brought here to the earth, our Mother Earth, to be the caretakers and stewards of our Mother Earth, to take care of it and to respect all the beings. We are all one big family on this earth, in this universe that we believe our Mother Earth is a living, breathing being. We have the utmost respect to our Creator, the highest respect, and then to our Mother Earth. We were to take only what our mother gives us for food and not more. In 1983, my grandfather told me, as we were sitting down watching TV, he said to me, as you and I are sitting here unawares and the whole world is going about their daily lives unawares, our Mother Earth is preparing herself to renew herself. In our ancestral belief, our Mother Earth ages as we do, but her aging process is in the millennia. And nutacht, renew. She is preparing to renew herself. She's very close to renewing herself. And that what we are witnessing today, he told me, I will not be here. And I believe they have prepared me for this, for today. That our Mother Earth, when she renews herself, she does so violently by turning herself ultimum, turning herself inside out, rearranging herself, reorganizing herself, and it is followed by uksukpak. Uksuk in our language is winter. Uksukpak is deep, deep winter. That's ice age. And once she has done her renewal process, she begins like a brand new baby, starting all over again. And he had told me that we are very, very close to returning to our old ancestral ways of survival. That is scary. His message I shared in London at the IMO, that we must take action today and be very aggressive of protecting our earth, what little ecosystems we have left on this earth, for our children, for our grandchildren. And if we fail, that we will be the consequences, our worldwide consequences. He told me about the loss of ice that we are witnessing, worldwide weather patterns changing, catastrophic disasters becoming frequent and bigger at magnitudes that man has not known.
Thank you, Delbert. Is that okay?
Okay.
Yeah. I want to pick up on something that you're sharing that's important. I know we have limited time, and I apologize. I think I wanted to ask Mellisa, because you're touching on something that's real important, and I think you touched on this too, is the long history and understanding of our people. And I was wondering if you could speak a little bit about what that means in the context of the elders that you work with, Mellisa.
So in regards to your comment and or question, mm-hmm. And thank you, Delbert, for sharing, for introducing it. It is without our elders that we couldn't be here today. You know, like, I am a very young elder in training, and I sit, in a panel of two gentlemen who are my elders, and I came all the way to DC with two of my elders, and without our elders, we wouldn't understand what to do, how to do, and also the networking and collaboration with our Western counterparts on how can we work together to preserve our way of life, how can we work together to make the necessary changes in regards to climate change that is here. It's not when, but it's here now. So it has always been our ancestors that have paved the way for us, and moving into the future, as I become an elder, in probably about 40 years or so, then it'll be my responsibility to work with our younger generations in how things are now and what they should expect moving forward.
Mm-hmm. Thank you, Mellisa. Did you want to comment on that at all? You talked a bit about elders in the video, or we could go on to the next question.
I could comment on that. I was just thinking about when you think about home, primarily trying to make a living, and when you think about your offspring, your kids, your grandkids, you're concerned about them. And when they actually sit at the resources with the proper tools that we have, from our perspective, as a village corporation, we have succeeded in that arena. We have a stake on the ground. We can operate in the rest of the world. But yet at home, it's so challenging to bring work home, raw resources, humans and land. You know, I want my kids to be able to go home and work and have jobs. That's a hard pill to swallow. I'll give you just a very brief story of where I come from. Having been successful in flying, I love to hunt. I love to be playing out in the middle of winter, just to be able to run like a little fox, enjoying the scenery, just enjoy the sea, just to be able to sit by the sea. You gotta feel that emotion. As I was getting ready to go hunt, I was feeling so blessed. At the same time, when I looked up, I see somebody walking down the street, head down. I had to ask him, what's going on with you? He said, I have no job, no food on the table. I verified that later. His house was actually empty of any food. And he was my neighbor. And that was, you know, that was rude awakening for my part, having lived my dream. And that's why I'm concerned here. You know, we have raw resources that we're dealing with, standing on them. And I hope and pray that we can work together to make a difference. Thank you.
Thank you, Hugh. I know that we're getting close on time, and I was sharing with the group that it's hard for me to want to stop any of you from speaking because there's so much good information that you all have and so many important stories to share. So I want to ask you, each of you, we have about 5 minutes left, is what role do you see our communities having in the changing Arctic, and what vision do you have for the future of the Arctic and its people? Just as an aspirational two questions for you. Do you want to start, Delbert?
From our ancestral times, we have this very powerful, intimate relationship with our Creator and our Mother Earth. As the senator said yesterday on the Arctic, that if we could put a do not disturb sign on there and not to disturb it, would be a great thing, but it's next to impossible. But we do need to work together and protect what we have left. We can feel our Mother Earth, the spirits, and we have this direct communion, spiritual communion with our Mother Earth. That is very powerful, near and dear in my heart, which was instilled into me by my grandfather. That we do need to take care of our Earth and take and work together for all of our children in the future. Thank you.
I want to address a little bit of this, if I may, from our village point of view. And when we brought together three entities that represent our village, the city of Wainwright, the tribe, and the corporation, we are able to sit down on a regular basis to discuss what's happening in the near future for our region. We serve as a unified point. A good situational awareness really does help. At the same time, it really does help with the decisions and having a seat on the table. More than that, kind of like a seat at our table. From a long distance point of view, our life has been dictated from outside sources. You know, and then having to see the changes and we're living in them and being partakers, and not really having, we have become very proactive because I know it works. We can't have our head in the iceberg. You know, the iceberg is slowly dissipating. And having grown up in that arena where we used to see large icebergs floating by, a large ice, you know, little kid, no concerns, but now that we see things are different. You know what Delbert was talking about, you know, just nodding from from the old folks' point of view. We have lived in that arena and know what we're talking about. At the same time, you know, when we're taken for granted at times, it makes it challenging for us, but still, I'm so thankful to be here to be sharing our concerns in the changing Arctic. We're living it. Thank you.
Thank you.
So as Indigenous people and the knowledge that we carry, especially from our elders, it's our right to be consulted and involved in many of the different changes that are occurring in the Arctic, from governments, not as stakeholders, but every decision that is made, we need to be included in those conversations because we live on the land, we live off of the sea. You know, anything from shipping to environmental issues, it's inherent that we be in those discussions. And as far as our vision for our future as Arctic people, again, it's just to be active as Indigenous people in the decision making, to have that collaboration with whatever system, you know, that is outside of our own. And at the end of the day, our future is the ocean. The ocean is our garden, as the late Georgiane Anasovic from Koyuk, Alaska had said, it is our responsibility to keep that garden, to nurture it as it has provided for our people, and to make sure that it's there for our future.
I really appreciate everyone sharing your thoughts. I know that we have to move on here. And I hope that each of you have heard and gotten just a little bit of the taste of what it is, the perspectives of Arctic Alaska Natives are. And I hope that you all have a chance to talk with our amazing panelists who made it all the way from some very rural communities, as you can see, across Alaska during breaks. I think we have a opportunity to partner and work with you to make sure that we have a strong Arctic going forward, whether it's working on national security issues, research, or things that impact our livelihood. Can we give a round of applause for our panelists? Thank you.
Thank you to the panel, and Liz, thank you for your leadership and moderation. I know we're a little bit over time, but we're just going to keep working through this. We're here for a lot of reasons. This is a biannual. This has been going on for 16 years, the eighth biannual. Lots of discussions in the past about research and research components, infrastructure, economic development. I would argue that the primary reason we are here is because of that panel. That's why we're here. Yes, national security. But if you're not taken, moved, captivated by the dramatic change and the impact on the communities that we all serve, I don't know what captivates you. And frankly, I don't know what motivates us anything more than what we just heard. So thank you very much. Thank you.